everybody, and welcome to the Human Echoes podcast, the show where we review oddball movies, have oddball discussions, and occasionally take questions from y'all, the oddball fans.
I'm Tony Southcott.
And I'm Albert Berg, and the oddball movie for this week is The Evil Within. Now, The Evil Within is a film from first and only time director Andrew Getty. Andrew Getty was the heir to a very large oil fortune, and he decided that he had a movie in him, and he wanted to get it out, and he was willing to spend a considerable, although not by Hollywood standards, I would say not exorbitant amount of money, to make this film, and the product is The Evil Within. The story of the movie is about a mentally challenged man who slowly becomes even more mentally unstable and possibly is in fact infected by a demon. And his journey as he deals with his problems, both internal and external.
There's a lot of internal problems here, too.
There are, and it's not just him. The interesting thing is that there's a whole family dynamic with him and his brother, played by Sean Patrick Flannery, Tony. That's what his name is from now on. I'm not even going back on that. That Sean wasn't Patrick. A stumble. Sean Patrick Flannery plays his brother, John. And John is sort of in a weird conundrum here because he's taking care of his brother. Apparently their parents have died. And he feels very indebted to his brother for reasons that we find out later in the movie. But he also is feeling the pressure of taking care of an adult person with the mind of a child. And, it takes over his life, and he has to, put up with the whims of this kid, and his girlfriend is not really interested in taking care of his brother full time. She's sympathetic to it, but she's like, listen, this is, I don't want to live in the same house with this guy forever. He wants to put him in a nice place, like a place that can take care of him, not the state-run hospital. And all the while that he's dealing with this, his brother is dealing with the mirror, which is reflecting back something very, very nasty in his soul.
Yeah.
And this movie is bonkers.
Yeah, that is the word for it.
Visually speaking, I mean, just the first, I want to say 4 or 5 minutes of this movie is one of the coolest things I've ever you see this sometimes in commercials, right? Where you have those really weird transitions, like physical, you're walking through something and then you like pull away a curtain and it's something else all of a sudden, even though they were physically like it's one of those for a good solid, at least 2 or 3 minutes leading into that. And it's just incredible. And it really sort of like slams you in the face. Like, hey, we're doing something here. We're getting crazy. We don't know what we're making, but we have the story to tell. And then it kind of settles into this more traditional narrative where you have this voiceover, and this voiceover goes for like 15 minutes at the beginning of the movie, where he tells, it's a little boy telling the story about how he has this dream about how he goes to the amusement park with his mother, and the amusement park is empty, and he wants to go on the haunted house ride. And there's all these not completely empty, there's barkers there manning the rides and stuff, and he wants to go on the haunted house ride. They go on the haunted house ride, and nothing happens. They run through the ride, they get off, and the little boy says to his mother, mommy, we should get our money back. That wasn't very scary. And his mom, like, takes her glasses off, and her eyes are mouths, and her real mouth and the two eye mouths says, what makes you think the ride is over? And then he wakes up, and
it's like
you're
a terrible
in
Snapchat filter back before they had that.
It wasn't that bad. I thought it looked okay.
No, I'm saying it was like terrible as in like that's horrifying.
Oh, right. Yes. The CG in this, there's actually a lot of physical effects. I think there are some digital effects, but there's a lot of like stop motion stuff happening in here, especially towards the end of the film. That's really beautiful and unnerving and works to the movie's tone in an incredible way. But that sets the tone for the whole film, which is that any moment in the film could be revealed to be a dream. And in fact, the whole film could be a dream. It's kind of on the same level as, and I'm blanking on the name of the movie, with
Phantasm.
The flying silver balls.
Phantasm.
Phantasm. Thank you, Tony. It's on that same level of Phantasm where you've got this unreality that pervades the whole thing, where there are elements that you look at and you think, okay, I'm pretty sure this does happen, but at any moment it could be revealed that, oh, we were in a dream for this whole time. And
yeah, and I felt like they were kind of trying to put that ambiguity in, but I didn't feel like it was that in the end.
Really?
But yeah, there's it seemed like there was a little more to it than that at the very end, and we don't want to get too much into what happens there other than that is definitely a way to put a climax on a movie.
It was the ending of this movie is very, very interesting. And the things that are revealed about what happened and why things are the way they are is also very interesting. But I liked that this movie, I've heard people talk about it as being this problematic thing. And the biggest issue that I think a lot of people are having as a hangup is that this mentally challenged man is referred to both by himself and others using the R word. They call him retarded.
It was also filmed like 15 years ago, so that was a lot more socially acceptable.
Possibly, although I'd say that's a word that I avoid using myself, and I would discourage my children from using and those kinds of things. But it's not on the spectrum of like the N word, where I'm gonna like drive a country mile to get around saying it. Like it's not like that, and I think for some people it is. And I'm not here to tell y'all that you're wrong for feeling that way, but it's not like. I'm going to call you out a little bit, Tony. I've heard you say that word before. I hope that's okay for me to say that. If not, fine. I can edit this out.
I also don't, like, I don't take as much offense to hearing it as you do. Like, it's one of those things where, I feel like people have put a lot of baggage on a word that actually can, that's not, like, it's not even a medical term. It's just, like, it makes sense. He has mental retardation. Like, his progress
has been retarded.
Well, it was,
at one point, it could be used as a medical designation. And I think that I don't think that it's used out of any particular malice, possibly ignorance. All right. Or possibly just the filmmaker feels like that's how these characters would talk. And it's also, I mean, you mentioned that it was shot in the year 2000. It doesn't feel like even
it
as
looks
modern
like
as
it
that.
Was shot in the year 2000, like the lighting and the camera work and everything. It feels old. Like, I kept having some weird issues with that, where it's like, it's a new movie, but it's not a new movie, but it's, like, it felt very much like 2000.
It felt almost more like 90s or even 80s to me. Like,
yeah, it definitely had that look. Like, there are times where it looks better than that, especially whenever it's doing the dream sequences, but, like, all the exterior shots and all the things outside, like, it had kind of a, not as bad as The Room, but, like, that sort of weird, like, not quite cohesiveness to it.
And I think some of that is definitely from the director and the creator, the guy behind this not being a movie person, a movie fan clearly, and not, by the way, I know you mentioned The Room, and there is some comparison to be made here. I think that you can definitely talk about compare and contrast, but this is not The Room. Okay.
No,
this is not comedically misguided.
The problem is like 15 minutes into the movie, they drop a line from The Room about someone being his favorite customer and things like that. So there are little moments where I was shaken from it. Like, there is an amateurish feel to certain scenes, and then there's kind of a deft hand feel to other scenes. I think a lot of that comes down to Frederick Kohler's performance.
Frederick Kohler does an amazing job as Dennis, and he has to do double or even triple duty because he's playing this man who does have this... He's slow. And yet, he also is... And they use a lot of these scenes where he's talking to himself in the mirror, and the mirror image is not as slow as he is. In some cases, it's just a little bit less. In some cases, it's, razor sharp and clear. And I think that ultimately gets to what the movie is trying to say. It's not about mental issues exactly. For me, what the film was, it was a meditation on identity itself and what is... at the core of identity, what makes up who you are. If you lost your mental faculties, what happens to the thing that was you? If you're displaced by another personality, what happens to the thing that was you? And that goes through a lot of this stuff. And I felt like that was, for me anyway, ultimately the driving thread through the movie, that it was about trying to find the self. And it's not a super clear theme, all right, and maybe I'm a little bit off base. It's an amateurish effort to a certain extent, but I don't think it's completely without guidance or knowledge of where it wants to go.
Yeah, well, from what I was reading on this, Andrew Getty was just absolutely obsessed with horror movies, and you see that whenever he's getting into that vein of this movie, he does it really, really well.
He does. I mean, there are the moments where the mentally challenged boy is walking through the Hall of Mirrors, beautifully shot, and I think I would imagine really difficult to do. You know, if you have all these mirrors, you don't, like, they didn't have the technology back then to digitally erase the camera in the mirror, at least not probably available to this guy. And you know, so much like wonderful stop motion effects put in this. There's several
the
monsters.
Of Michael Berryman, like he was they list him as Cadaver, but he's basically the main demon that is influencing Dennis.
And he's the least, I mean, he's very creepy. Like he has a wonderful basic demonic look. There's, you can over design something like him. I think you can put all different flourishes on him and just, he's just a dude. His face is a little bit messed up and he's got all gray skin and his eyes are weird, but yeah. He's like, you see that screenshot and they've used it on the cover of the DVD and you like, that's a monster that if this film gets any kind of cult status is going to be very recognizable. People are going to know what that thing is from this movie, because once you've seen him and you know, when he pops up, when he does his jump scares and, you know, turn around, somebody turns out to be him, all that stuff. Like, those things are going to be, they are creepy, A, because of how they're shot, but also just because of how this guy looks and how unnerving he is.
Well, Michael Berryman's been in a lot of different horror movies. Like, he's also in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, just ton of different movies as kind of that creepy, weird guy. So like it was a very good casting choice, and probably the creepiest thing he does in the entire movie happens in the first like 3 minutes, where he like basically installs the zipper.
I almost forgot about that. That's such a great scene. Oh yeah, so the like at opening of the movie, it's after the monologue, right? It's mostly after the monologue. He's, you know, he comes up to the main character Dennis, the slow kid, and he like flips him over in bed, and there's very, I would say, implied sexual energy in that scene. Like the way he's coming at him seems like, oh man, something's going to happen. But instead of whether or not that is something that is in the subtext of the movie, what specifically happens is he staples a zipper to the back of Dennis's back and head, and then unzips it and climbs inside Dennis in this really effectively shot sequence of, I mean, you know, there's cuts and stuff. Like, you can figure out how they did it, but it's still just gross.
Yeah.
And it really speaks to the underlying image, too, of what's inside. Like, what is the thing inside of you that drives you? Where is your core, your soul? And that the question that movie is asking throughout, and again, sort of going into the whole demon possession thing that is argued to be, you know, you could maybe say that maybe it's not a real thing, that it's a byproduct of some other stuff that happened in the movie. But regardless of whether it's literally true or not, if something else is driving your body, where are you? What happens to you? It's something that we've kind of touched on in the past with like Get Out, where you'd have, you know, that the whole hypnotism thing is about losing the self. I don't want to get any more spoilery than that, but I think that that's relatively evident from the trailers.
Yeah, that's in the first minute of every trailer they have for that movie.
So I really dug that. There's the monster that he sees in the pirate restaurant, and the way that that's executed. Oh, wow. That was something else. I mean, it wasn't even necessary. Like, I wasn't scared of that. It didn't like have me, oh, I can't sleep tonight because I saw that. But it's just a really, really well done monster.
And that's one thing that I need to go back and look at for a lot of these sequences, because there are a lot of different monsters that don't get a whole lot of screen time.
There's the spider thing that comes to get the guy at the end. And the plot of the movie kind of revolves around this inner personality talking to Dennis, who wants to be smart, right? He wants to have more in life. He and it's again, very, feels very, I don't want to say it's not exploitative. In my mind, it was an exploitation of him and his mental illness. And maybe it's just because I'm not sensitive.
It's a hard line to walk too with that, Mike.
It is. But to me, it felt like at least his inner struggle, that wanting to be like a normal person, seeing what everybody else had, and knowing that he was inferior in his mind, and yet still having all the drives and desires of a full-grown man. You know, specifically, there's the girl at the ice cream shop, which, by the way, where is that ice cream shop where they serve ice cream in bikinis? But
they're around. I've seen those before.
Okay. Not apparently not in Florida, the Sunshine State, where it's very hot.
There's a strip club coffee shop in Denver where they serve you basically like coffee every morning in lingerie. So there's stuff like that around.
Okay. Also, speaking of coffee, they just happen to serve coffee at this ice cream shop, which is just so they can have like a plot point later. Like, we woke up and we were really tired. Let's go get coffee at the ice cream shop. It gets a little bit clunky at the end.
Yeah, some of those, like, that entire sequence after they wake up is where it started getting a little bit sticky for me on things. Like, I was trying to enjoy that, but it just got weird. Like, whenever they're going to talk to the guy about the possible tapes that got mixed up, or the cassettes.
That character was the best, and he was not in any of the rest of the movie. You could tell that they got, like, they had planned to shoot more of him, or he was in other parts of the script, and they just didn't get to it because of... I don't know, whatever.
It's like,
Mr. Getty's
it's Pete. Let's go talk to Pete. He's the only person we know.
Pete is my favorite character in the movie. I just want to say that. Like, his one scene
there. Props
to
actor Tim Bagley for that one.
Yeah?
Yeah.
He just doesn't care. He's like, you guys are stupid. I don't. But to speak to your point about that scene, I think some of that is because you're supposed to feel like that scene is mimicking the dreamlike quality of what Dennis has been experienced through the whole movie. And it turns out not to literally be, but as an audience, you're kind of put in this, maybe things don't have to make exact sense here. So even there, I could almost justify the, let's go get coffee at the ice cream shop.
Well, it did have a lot of dream tropes in it. Like whenever you're driving down like what should be a busy road and there's just nobody there. And like you go up and you try to like put your hand on somebody's shoulder and like it's completely the wrong person and they start getting a little bit touchy back with you. Like that giant guy that was supposed to be his therapist. Like that entire sequence feels like a dream.
But to go back to what I kind of tangented off from to begin with, you really do feel for Dennis and his, you know, his plight here that he has, again, has these wants and needs and wants to connect to people and wants to have a girlfriend like. And, you know, practically everybody else in the world wants to have some kind of human romantic connection. And he's not able to make that happen because he's slow. All right. And that's just it's not going to work.
Probably the most uncomfortable scene for me of the whole movie.
But it was uncomfortable from a real place of uncomfortableness.
Yeah,
it wasn't.
Go ahead. Like the woman who's serving the ice cream, he's obviously got a crush on her and everything. And she's very sweet to him. Like, she seems like she's kind of entertaining him. She likes him as a person and all this. And whenever he starts having her write all this stuff down in a notebook, basically, like, forcing her. It's a really weird way of asking for a date, the way, like, she has to just kind of be very honest and reject him. And that felt pretty genuine, too. Like, she did it the way that you probably should for a situation like that. And it was just so uncomfortable. I actually had to turn the volume off and read the subtitles. Like, I was just cringing a little too hard.
I mean, it did make, I didn't have to go quite that far, but it definitely was like putting you in that unease. And I thought that, again, so to go, which it goes back to even a larger point that I was starting to make, I don't, from things like that, I don't think that the movie is making fun of Dennis for his problems. Like it empathizes with him and the influence that's coming from outside, whatever it might happen to be, is taking advantage of him. It's taking advantage of this desire to be normal. And it says, hey, and it's a really, like, you can even see how this argument would make sense to someone who's just not, like, is a little bit slow, because the demon says to him, there's a puzzle that you have to solve to get smart. And they've been giving you the clues to this puzzle your whole life. They tell you it's wrong to kill things like cats, but they give you meat to eat. Why would they? Obviously, they had to kill the meat. It's cool for the farmers to kill the meat. Why can't you go kill a cat? And convinces him that this is the smart test that he has to pass, and escalates that up from animals to children to family members. And it feels real enough. It's, you know, even a dentist eventually catches on that, wait a minute, I'm not getting any smarter and I'm doing these horrible things and I feel bad. But the way this thing from inside him manipulates him feels very, very real and horrifying. And you could see why he would decide to go along with this.
And that goes back once again to Frederick Kohler's performance on that. Because this is, it would be hard to be able to switch back and forth as easily or as often as he did. Like, I'm looking at some of the stuff that he's done recently. He's been in a ton of different shows, like nothing really huge. He was in American Horror Story for a little bit, but otherwise, I hadn't seen him in much before.
He does a great job. He has a good face for it, too, which sounds mean, maybe, but you know how you've seen people. I think generally when someone's slower, they're not probably thinking about calories too much, so he has that little bit pudgier face that you would probably see on somebody like this, and he just, like, he does, like, the mannerisms and everything. Again, there's the question of sensitivity of, like, what does it mean to act like someone who has mental problems and is slow? Is that okay? Is that disrespectful? The way he pulls it off, it did not feel disrespectful to me. But again, I've told you sort of where my level is and how I feel about this. It might, it clearly was disrespectful to several other reviewers that I read that really found this very uncomfortable to watch. So I want people to be warned of that. Depending on what your tolerance is, this might not be the movie for you.
Yeah, and you can't really pick it up from the trailer, like, to see how comfortable you're going to be with it.
But I do think that it doesn't come from, and another thing that I read a lot was, man, this guy is really trying to exorcise some demons. Like, he must be working through some stuff. That may be true. Okay. He's not a lot. He died in 2015. So we don't actually get to ask him what he was thinking, but his, like, maybe this is just a guy that had a story that he wanted to tell that he thought was cool. And, you know, if there are unfortunate implications, it's possible he just didn't, like, care or think that they were very important to him. And I'm willing to give this the benefit of the doubt as just, I've got this story. I think it's cool. It's, you know, this, again, it's not nothing you've never seen before. The whole dream within a dream. I mean, you know, the whole Freddy series is based on all of that. And as we mentioned earlier, the Phantasm movies, Inception obviously did it in a very more clinical way. But you've seen this idea that you could be in a dream and not know it at any point in the series, but it's just executed pretty well. Yes, with the sort of, not with the deftest hand, and sometimes it's a little bit over the top with things. There's a scene where Sean Flatrick Plannery's character is talking to the social services lady that wants to take Dennis away, and they keep doing this, like, white pan that you've seen in a lot of movies, and it's a cool pan, but they do it like 800 times.
Yeah, they need to slow that camera down a little bit. That was that was just ridiculous. It could have definitely been worse, but, like, every time you, like, pass a candlestick, it's all of a sudden a different camera angle and just back and forth and back and forth, and it really didn't feel like it fit with the mood of the movie at that time either.
Because I would contend that it was still trying to create that, like, filmic, you know, film between you and the movie kind of dream like sequence, but it definitely seemed a little bit clunky and overhanded. But again, that's the kind of thing you're going to get from a first time filmmaker who has seen a lot of films and is a fan of things and maybe doesn't know how to use them in moderation.
But I'm glad he took the shot too. Like, if he's going to put this movie out, if he's going to sink $4 to $6 million of his own money into it, like, he just went after it, and that's awesome.
Yeah, and I think that's the best thing that we can say about this film. I think, if especially if you're a fan of horror effects of monsters, and that's not to say that's the only thing that's any good in this film, because we have had films like that where it's like, man, the monster is cool, but everything else. It's not one of those films. But I don't know if this film is for everybody, but I do think that it's going to find an audience and will become something of a cult classic, because I enjoyed it. It really resonated with me in a lot of different levels, and it was uncomfortable to watch, but not, like, I don't know, not so much that I wanted to stop watching it. I wanted to find out what happened, and when I did find out what happened, it was very interesting, and I guess all I'm going to say is I recommend it. I think everybody should check it out.
I can't quite recommend it as strongly as Al, because I actually don't really like movies that have dream sequences or books with dream sequences. I always feel like they're very ineffective and it takes away a lot of the weight. But this one actually was able to execute it better than most for like a movie based around dreams.
There's definitely something to be said for, hey, maybe this actually happened. Like, let's have a movie where things for real happen. A lot of movies have done good things with dream sequences, but it does get a little old, and you do have to be good. And the fact that this movie doesn't completely fall on its face with all the dream sequence stuff is a testament to, you know, the idea that maybe, you know, it's just not, like, it did have some thought behind it, and it was not terribly done, in my opinion. So, that's everything we have to say about the movie for this week. Tony, I did want to ask you, you were at Anomolycon this week. What was that like? What kind of stuff did you see there? Is Anomolycon also? Because I do know, but tell the viewers and the listeners at home.
Anomolycon is a con in Denver, Colorado that basically it's steampunk / alternative history. And it ended up being like a really interesting type of con because they've spent a lot of time trying to make this place like as inclusive as possible. So, like, being the normal straight white guy, like, it actually was a little bit weird. It, like, literally probably the queerest place I've ever been to, and that's kind of the point. Like, they're, okay. Like that is not an insult in any way. That is one of the things that they were going for. Like, it was probably the most gender fluidity I've ever seen anywhere. You've got, like, dudes walking around in corsets. You've got, like, all sorts of different stuff. Like, gender did not matter at this con. And that was something I didn't expect because I know steampunk and, like, the sort of alternate timelines and stuff like that end up, like, attracting a sort of audience for that. But it's also run by a lot of people who are trying to make a space where people are comfortable with all this. And sometimes I think the policies that they had might go a little bit too far. People got kicked out for microaggressions, for misuse of pronouns, things like that. But for the most part, it was just a very, very, like, calm and easy place. And it was a lot of fun. Like, there was a lot of cool stuff going on there. Like, some of the panels were good. It was a lot less, like, big names than, say, Denver Comic Con. But it actually felt like there was some really quality stuff going on there. I got to meet Wesley Chu, who wrote a book that I really enjoyed last year called Lives of Tao. I met a lot of other smaller comic book artists. They had like 6 panels on how to be a good DM for Dungeons & Dragons, so that's mostly the panels I went to. So that was a
you
lot
got,
of fun.
You got all kinds of feedback about your potential group.
Yeah.
And why none of us want to be healers.
You guys just don't want to do the holy trilogy that is in, like, all games where it's the healer, DPS, and tank. And I'm sympathetic to that, but it's also, like, I'm just trying to figure out how that works. And I'm actually having to generate a story that can create ways that you guys stumble onto more healing potions and things like that just to try to do this properly. So it's going to be fun. It's going to be interesting. Like, it's definitely going to lead to some interesting encounters, and you guys are going to have to play more clever than a lot of groups. Like, you will not have a group that just runs straight into anything. That's going to be an interesting thing. But whenever I was talking to the guys, I was like, how do I do this? And they're like, well, find another group. And if you can't, then find another group and tell them you can't do it. And then maybe if they still can't do that, then try it this way. So it was fun to get some feedback there. I'm actually sending you, like, a questionnaire so you can fill out some more information about your character, even though yours is more fleshed out than any of the others so far.
Okay.
I also got these, which my fantastic new metal dice.
Which I can hear it.
I'm definitely not.
It's just a bag right now, isn't it?
It's in a bag, but it's about to be on a table, and you'll definitely be able to hear this, like
thunder rolls.
Yeah, it's just like an authoritative roll, and really dig on this. Met some. Like, I think the merch section of this was actually a little bit cooler than Denver Comic Con, even though it was a lot smaller. It was just a lot more handcrafted stuff. It wasn't like, well, here's 500 different comic book shirts. It's more like, no, this is like a copper gun we put together that looks steampunk, that has a bunch of LEDs built into it. Or here's like a whole ton of different corsets or cool like hand leather crafted gear to set up your cosplay, that sort of stuff. So they had some really cool merch there. I only ended up buying dice because whenever it's handcrafted merch, it costs a lot more.
Yeah. that's the truth.
So
you can buy some nice stuff if you had a lot of money.
Yeah.
But when you don't, you go to the thrift store and hope that somebody's throwing their nice stuff away.
Have you ever heard of Steven Universe?
The what? Oh yeah, I've heard of Steven Universe.
Yeah, like
I haven't watched it. I've seen like clips and stuff, and I've turned on the Cartoon Network when it's on, and I've heard. I mean, Hannah loves that show.
Yeah.
So that's our friend Hannah Elizabeth, also a member of our team here at Human Echoes.
Yep. But she has a Monday stream that's always a lot of fun. I was watching it last night whenever she was playing Don't Starve, over on Beam.
It's just not something I've ever gotten into. Why do you ask? I assume that there's something related.
Well, like one of the people that was teaching how to do like the DM stuff and how to run a group and everything was the writer for that show. So that was a kind of cool thing. And it's like after talking with them for a little bit, I'm more likely to check out Steven Universe because I've heard it's a good thing. My DM loves it. Like, I don't know what it is with DMs and that particular thing, but whatever.
I think it's got a lot of fantasy elements, but like sort of written for kids. I that just like sort of the general idea that I've had. It seems like a different angle. It reminds me of Adventure Time, which I have watched Adventure Time, but I haven't really gotten into Adventure Time. But there are those sort of like Adventure Time is for kids, but it has like it's the world that it takes place in can kind of be dug a little bit deeper by adults. So I assume that this is just my I might be way off, but it feels like that Steven Universe might have that same kind of thing where the tone is very much younger based, but that there is stuff to appreciate if you really have time to think about it.
Yeah, it's kind of like Invader Zim and some of these other shows that appeal to both audiences, or like
it really
Samurai
seems like there's
Jack
a lot of that
back
around. I just gotta say, like I think I've mentioned this in the past, but it seems like a great time to be into cartoons.
Yeah.
For kids, for adults. I just occasionally turn on Cartoon Network, but I see a lot of really interesting stuff going on over there that feels very manic and like creative in how it comes across. And, you know, I mean, SpongeBob felt revolutionary when I was, you know, 17 or 18. Like, oh, wow, this is something I can laugh at. Because, I mean, granted, I was stupid at the time. But
we're all stupid still, at 18. Like
I still kind of enjoy SpongeBob, but it like that seems to have been sort of the baseline now, and now everything is like jumping off of that. Whereas I think in the past cartoons were much more not normal. I mean, you'd still have crazy stuff happening in cartoons, but the types of stories and the types of characters they have are just really bonkers.
They were a lot more slapstick and didn't have as much to say. Whereas you're seeing a lot of bigger messages making their way into cartoons now.
Yeah. Old school cartoons are really great too, by the way. Like the good ones from back in the day, the, you know, like your Roadrunners and your Bugs Bunnies. And I mean, the like how they animated that stuff was incredible. And I still think that that's something that people can look at and really marvel at. But when I was a kid, cartoons did not interest me. Maybe cartoons are for adults, Tony. Maybe that's just the problem. Maybe
possibly
5-year-olds don't care about cartoons.
I know we do have a cartoon being turned into a movie next week that we're all excited to see.
What?
Ghost in the Shell
movie? That's not next. Oh, you mean next week? Yep. Yes. Okay, because when this comes out, this week is Life and Power Rangers. And I'm like of a conundrum which one I'm going to run down. I think I'm going for Life.
Yeah, but I say, sort of want to. If you pick Power Rangers, I'm going to do Life because that looks really interesting.
Okay, here's the thing. We'll talk about this afterwards too, but I just like, I want to see what Power Rangers does. I'm very interested in Life. I want to talk about Life. I you know,
well,
it's got
better
reviews.
Let's talk about Life. What's going on?
Well, I've got some stuff. I'll tell you what's going on in my life. My keyboard crapped out, Tony.
That sucks.
Okay, so like right before recording the podcast, this is my keyboard. You'll notice that the people who are watching on the stream will notice that, or the video will notice that the W, or yeah, no, not W's here, but A, S, and D are all gone. Control has been rubbed raw. And that's all fine. The fact that I can't read the keys is all great. But
Al is all about the short the shortcuts, so
I
think
do
that
a lot
he does not
of keyboard
need to
shortcuts
ever see what's on a keyboard.
But when I was starting like using it this morning, the right shift button stopped working, and I couldn't type like a capital C. So I'm using this keyboard, which I am not used to, has a very different feel. Like just getting my hands positioned on the keys is different, but that's what I'm doing right now. Maybe I'll pop the keys on the other one and clean them off or something. But it's very it's weird. It's a weird experience. You get like your hands meld to a keyboard that you really get used to. And I don't know if you get that new laptop experience, Tony. You know what I'm talking about?
It's worse with laptops though, because they have varying sizes on the keyboards.
Yes. I have two laptops, and I've gone back to using my Chromebook a lot lately, to stream stuff, to stream video, just because the battery life is insane and the speakers are better, on it, and the one that I have. And I like, it's just, you can't, once you're like, I'm used to typing on my laptop, and I get to my Chromebook and I'm like, my hands aren't in the right place. This other keyboard's offset. I've got used to that now. I hate it, but I got used to it.
It just makes me feel like my fingers are way too fat or something like that. I kind of have petite fingers, like as far as the size of my hands. And maybe it's just my family, because my dad and my brother-in-law dwarf my hands. Like, it's just ridiculous how big their hands are. But like, I try to use my old netbook, and man, I was always double hitting keys.
Well, netbooks are just generally, I think that
they're
everybody's probably going to have problems with
those. Except for like Google Chromebooks.
Yeah. But Chromebooks are, I think, not a huge segment of the laptop population, but I would, if mine was pooped, I would consider buying another one.
Yeah.
As like a non, like if it's not your main computer, or even if it is, if you're not, like the only reason, like the 99% of the reason that I bought another laptop was because I want to be able to record onto something, and Chromebook did not have a good non-internet-based recording option. That had stereo and stuff, and so I couldn't go with it. And then the new quibble, by the way, my new laptop also does not have stereo recording option. I didn't know that. I didn't know that they were stopping putting stereo mic jacks in laptops. They're like, oh, you only need mono. It's like, I did need stereo. Thank you for not telling me until after I got it home and had, you know, used it for 2 or 3 days.
I just booby trapped my floor.
What?
You know, I was telling you how that D4 is really, really sharp. Well, I was messing with it, wondering if
it
I was going to bring it
like
up.
It's just like a three-sided spike.
Yeah, it's a three-sided spike made of brass.
I mean, the bottom is a side, so that's the fourth side.
And I lost it on the floor for a little bit. I was kind of freaking out while you were talking. I was like, my worst nightmare is coming true.
I live in a house with kids and Legos, so you don't have any room to talk. I have another show and tell option, by the way. This is something I'm very, very excited about. Something I've been coveting for a while. This is, Tony can't see it. This is my vinyl copy of the Sharknado 3 soundtrack.
Isn't it like bright red too? Like the actual
Yes,
disc?
It is. And clear. You can see through it.
You can see
it's
the music.
Beautiful. It's beautiful. Oh no, I dropped it on the keyboard.
Al is so hipster that he went and got the vinyl for Sharknado.
Well, I have most of the soundtrack available for free to me on Amazon Prime. And so I've listened to all the songs already, and I liked a lot of them. And I have my record player that I've been playing around with records from the thrift store. And I thought this would be my first like official newish record purchase. I've had my eye on it for a while. And I had some like points on my Amazon credit card that could go towards that. And I was like, it's on for Prime. It's $10. It's used, but it's like still new in the packaging. And I got it. And it doesn't work on my record player, Tony.
Why not?
Because the needle, so you can't see it. I've got this, it's a Songfest portable record player from like when my dad was a kid. Okay? He owned this and like played records in his my grandma's basement, and the needle has worn so thin that, and on a larger record and a new record like this that has, you know, like the grooves still pretty fresh, it skates across the grooves as like trying to pull towards the inside, like the inner tracks will play okay, and there's not a replaceable needle on it. So yeah. I'm in the market waiting for like a little spare cash to buy myself a new record player that'll have a replaceable needle.
I'm surprised you haven't found one at the thrift store. You go there every week.
They don't have them. They're like a super hot commodity. Trust me. Like I have looked. I look every week when I go to the thrift store. There are not record players. People are either holding on to them, or like when they do go to the record store, the other hipsters who are there before me snap them up.
I can see that. You just got to get one of the ones that use a laser instead of a needle.
Those don't work on clear records, though.
That sucks.
Yeah, and like anything that's not black. So I've got my eyeball on like I've seen a lot of really cool colored records, and I want to own them half just for the like aesthetic value. So I'm gonna just go with the needle stuff for now. I do have my eye on one from Amazon that's like about $30, and it has built-in speakers and does the whole if you want to record a USB thing, you can. It has like tone control and stuff. It seems really nice for the price. I'm not the hipster that's gonna be just because I don't have the money to be. That it's going to go out and like, I have a hi-fi record system, y'all. I just want something I can drop a needle and listen to some songs on and have fun with, which is what I still do. The singles work fine on this record player. You know, they have the 45 singles. And because of the angle, like the arm moves in further, they're not as liable to skate with that. But and like I said, the inner tracks on this record play mostly okay. I'm itching to hear, you know, like, the Sharknado theme and all the songs from Quint that's on there. It's a good soundtrack.
I have not played vinyl in so long. I keep reading that vinyl sales are starting to outstrip CD sales in a lot of places. A lot of genres anyway. It's becoming
there's no point. Like at this point, if you're just going to buy casual music, you're going to buy it digitally, right?
Yeah.
You're going to just pick up. But if you want to own something that's like the only reason to own vinyl is because you want that like cool physical experience of like it's something special, right? It's the treating yourself to, you know, a nice dinner out rather than eating chicken McNuggets at your house, because the chicken McNuggets will give you the calories that you need, but there's something nice about going somewhere special and eat. So you don't, if you have a soundtrack that you really like, you know, and you're into the vinyl thing, obviously, you're going to go to, that's going to be your go-to. Obviously, yes, you can own it on digital, and it's much more convenient, and I'm...
Well, often whenever you buy the records now, you get a digital copy with it, like, or at least most of the times that I've seen it, they give you the voucher for it. So
yeah, there's a lot of stuff like that. And the cool thing with records, too, is there's, some of them have extra features, like they'll have tracks that go in between the other tracks with extra songs on them. So, and that you don't get on the MP3. I think Jack White does a lot of that with his records. And so I'm sort of side-eyeing the Lazaretto vinyl copy. But we'll see. We'll see what goes there.
He's also kind of obsessed with the whole process of printing vinyl. I think I've seen like 4 different videos where they're showing like his own record press for his labels.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Elaborate on that a little bit, because I don't know that I mean, I know that how they press records, but you're saying he's like sitting there in his basement pressing his own records like by hand?
Well, I think it's more like a warehouse that like he owns, like out in like out in Memphis or something. But like I'm thinking specifically of a Dead Weather video, which probably like out of all the bands he's done, I'm not sure how many people have heard of the Dead Weather, but I actually really like their stuff. And like, it just shows them, like, kind of picking colors and pressing the actual record and making it all themselves and just getting to see the forms and all that. And I've seen it in another video, but I couldn't tell you which one.
Okay. So they're very pretty, too, especially if you get one with good color. You know, there's something nice about that, you know, the visual of pulling something out of a sleeve. It just feels, again, yes, not as convenient as other ways to play music, but I think that the record will stick around. I do think that it's not just hipster. It's, you know, it's something that's a little different, a little cool. And because it feels different and cool and tactile, I think it'll still appeal to a limited number of people.
It's also shifting the focus of the music a little bit, because so much music is consumed like as a playlist that you've curated and put a bunch of stuff together. Like, it forces you to make it the focus of the room where you are where you're listening to just the one album and seeing what an artist has to say. It becomes more of an experience of the album instead of like, well, this single's awesome, I'm just going to listen to this one and move on to 50 other things on YouTube.
And that kind of ties into something that I've been thinking about lately. We talked about it a couple of episodes ago on the podcast. about focus, right? About doing maybe not specifically about doing one thing at a time, but about how distracted our lives are and how we all have our phones in our pockets and how there's always something there. And I've really been trying to make an effort lately to do one thing at a time. Like, so last night, and this is just one example, but we went out and did camping in the backyard because it was beautiful weather. And I didn't want to have to drive and, you know, have to deal with scheduling and moving around stuff and getting back. But it's real easy to do in the backyard, and we made a fire and all that stuff. And while I was out there, didn't bring my phone. I had my phone. It's when it was in the house, and I did look at it a couple times when I came in to, like, get food or whatever. But I specifically made the effort to, I'm not going to carry this with me. I'm just going to be outside with my kids. And I've been trying to apply that to several different things, you know, with work and with, you know, just my life in general. And it feels right. It feels good to be sort of decluttering my mind and focusing on one thing at a time. I hope it sticks. Sometimes you try to make a change and that bounces, and that's fine if it does. If a year down the road you hear me on the podcast, I'm like, I'm so distracted with everything and I listen to my phone all the time. Well, then you'll know it didn't stick. But it does. It's a fun experiment so far, and I'm enjoying it.
I really need to do something like that because it took me 4 hours to watch this movie yesterday.
Yeah? Yeah, see, I specifically, and this was something that I did actually stop it and get up because of family stuff. It was in the afternoon, and the kids were trying to take their nap, and, you know, I got up and got a drink at one point. But I did specifically tell myself, all right, I was watching on my laptop, but I said no phone, and if I do go do something else, I'm pausing the movie, and I'm going to focus on that, and then I'm going to come back to the movie rather than, like, I'm trying to do two things at once.
Yeah. Well, I'm at the point where I will not text while a movie is going on unless I pause it, and that's part of the reason why it took so long. But also, just, like, I've done that for movies before, and I end up getting into the review, and I'm like, what did I watch? What was this? I don't even remember the title. Like, I was too distracted.
If it's a real bad one, I think I forgive myself if it's just, like, I hate everything about this. I want to... But it is a good exercise not to be bouncing back and forth from one thing to the other. And it trains your something Joe said, and I don't know exactly how much research he has to back this up, but I assume that it's the truth because it sounded good when he said it, was that, yes, this is how my brain works, was that you're like, it's not that you're unfocused, so you're doing 9 things at once. It's you're unfocused because you're used to trying to do 9 things at once. Like, you can train your brain to do, like, one thing at a time. And I think that there's a lot of value in that. So, or Joe's making stuff up.
It sounds pretty good. I'll subscribe to that a little bit. I know that I've been trying to do the multitasking thing for so long. The only way I can focus is with Pomodoros, where I turn my phone over and just, like, all right, this half hour is for art. This half hour is for, like, doing promotion. It's just like I cannot function without doing those little 30-minute sections. Otherwise, it just turns into like 3 minutes of crap done on something over an hour, and it's like I can't do that anymore. I don't have time. I've been doing that, like, or I used to do that way more because I was trying to do everything at once. I still have a problem finishing like micro projects and things like that. It's hard to get something off my list sometimes, but it's gotten a lot better, partially because 5 Facts made me get better at each stage of something.
I don't have a good transition for this, but I did want to ask you if you've been watching the Iron Fist show.
No, I saw
Netflix.
A thing that was like 56 cuts in 30 seconds.
It was like 46 cuts in 40 seconds, I think. But yes, that scene was not as chaotic as I think I've tweeted this. Actually, I was like still nowhere near as bad as Resident Evil, the final chapter, which had some cuts that were a frame and a half, not literally a half a frame because that wouldn't work, but like just like clip and you're gone. Okay, yeah, this is edited a little bit frenetically, but I don't think that's. There are better fight scenes in the show than that one, and it's I could tell what was going on in that fight scene, so it didn't bother me as much.
Well, it's just we've been spoiled by fight scenes that are a lot better. Like, you look at the first season of Daredevil and the way they did those. It was a lot longer sequences. Like, you see that the hallway scene in the prison with Punisher. You see, like, Luke Cage is probably the least interesting of the fighters just because he doesn't actually look like he knows how to fight.
Well, he's just a big guy who can't get hurt. He doesn't really need to know how to fight.
Yeah, but he could
just
do
punch
so much
people.
Better.
I didn't
just get him
I didn't
in a boxing
Luke
gym
Cage.
For a while.
I honestly, like, I got about 40 minutes into the first episode of Luke Cage and just gave up because I felt like, wait a minute, who are these people? What is this? I just got, like, annoyed and confused at how much new stuff was happening that I didn't understand. It's like, wait, why is there a drug dealer? How does this... Luke Cage just works in his shop or his place? But it's going to be... I don't know. It threw me off. But somehow, Iron Fist, the least well-reviewed of all the Marvel heroes on Netflix, is the one that's got... Not its hooks into me exactly, but I'm just like kind of enjoying watching it because Iron Fist is a complete doofus. He's a clueless idiot who's just stumbling through this plot. Like, well, I wonder what happened to my family. They crashed in a jet. Really would like to talk to you guys about it. We're going to put you in a mental asylum for saying that you're, what's the guy's name? Danny Rand. You're not Danny Rand. He's like, but I really do want to talk to y'all guys. Can I talk to you about what happened to my dad now? Yes, like that's his whole MO. He just keeps pestering people until they give him what he wants. There's a girl who he wants to be in her dojo. And like the first episode, he's like, can I come to your dojo and train people? And she's like, no. And then like he shows up. He's like, I need to stay at your dojo. And she's like, get out. And he's like, I'm still here. I know you said to get out, but I'm still here the next morning. She's like, no, you're for real. I need to get out. He's just like persistent and he's not brooding or intense at all. He doesn't have any intensity. He's just sort of chill and like,
it kind of looks like that was the hand in his fighting style too. Like he's just kind of like flowed with the situation. He doesn't seem like there's a, I don't know. It's weird. It's weird.
Well, I think you've hit on something, Tony. I think that this is actually, for me, this is intentional. Okay. The way I read this character is his total, not complete obliviousness, but just sort of acceptance of stuff that's happening and how that does tie into his fighting style. I think that is the character. I think that, and I like that. I like that he's not like, oh, I'm gonna fight the bat. I mean, he does sort of like, he's like, well, I've got this destiny where I'm supposed to fight the hand. Do you guys know where the hand is? Oh, cool. I'd like to talk to the hand.
I say, as it was pointed out to me, that the hat I'm currently wearing is actually a Clueless reference. So I'm wearing a hat based on an Alicia Silverstone movie from the 90s.
Okay. Is it the You Can't Sit With Us hat?
Yeah. And the whole Talk to the Hand reference, you know.
I didn't know that was from that. I've never seen Clueless. Have you seen Clueless?
I've had a sister. I was forced to watch it. I can't remember much about it, but yeah.
I'm not judging or anything. I just was curious. Clueless? No, I do wonder where you got the hat, though.
I don't know. It showed up in my life, and I've been wearing it ever since.
Oh, okay.
I never bought this hat. It just found me. I have no idea where. Maybe I was drunk and stole it. No, I don't steal stuff.
It was like an ex-girlfriend's hat. Like, you just walked away, and like, she never felt, hey, I don't really like that. I didn't like Clueless that much anyway. He can have the hat. Is it one of those things? You're like, oh, man. This hat's hardcore. It says you can't sit with us. Yeah.
One of my exes. This fits with my gruff persona. And hoodies. The hoodies I miss the most, though. Even though I had three of the same hoodies, so I still have one of them.
Why'd you get rid of hoodies?
Like, they were just over there, and I wasn't going back.
Oh, it was a relationship. I missed the part where you talked about relationships.
Yeah, it was my exes.
Okay.
It's like, but my Stark shirt. I wanted that.
Has enough time passed? Like, maybe she still got it.
Yeah, probably.
You just, like, send her a text and be like, okay, things ended bad, but...
They didn't end that bad. It was mostly amicable.
Okay.
I've gotten better about that as I get older and being like, hey, things aren't working out right now. I'm sorry. Let's just move on.
That's the adult thing to do.
It still sucks, but it's better than it used to be.
Oh, it does, yeah. I just now, like, I was out, you remember, I was talking about how we were camping out in the yard yesterday, and so one of the things that I did while we were out in the yard is I was in the shed, sort of just throwing stuff away that I didn't need anymore, that I didn't love anymore, and I finally got around to throwing away the letters that I wrote to, like, my first love of my life. I was like, yep, I still have a little bit of, like, a twinge here, but this is just gonna be let go now.
Yeah.
This is over. It's 100% for sure over, but there was still that moment where you're like,
whatever, Al.
Represents something so difficult, you know, so important to me emotionally in my formation that I can't let go of it, and I'm now beyond that person enough to let go of it.
I've kept one thing from all of my other relationships that's like that. It was, My ex used to love getting, like, dance pictures. So if I ever find this, I might have to show you guys. It's, like, a chronicle of every high school dance ever, because I was with this girl long enough. And it's just, like, this long, like, accordion-style thing of, like, me in various, like, formal attire. Fresh-faced 16-year-old me.
Yeah, we used to be younger, didn't we, Tony?
Yeah. And she's the reason I still happening. Like redheads, even though they're crazy.
Oh, the young people are our future.
Yep. By the way, we did get two questions over the course of this, if we want to try to answer them very quickly.
Hit it!
First question comes from Chris Becker. What is your favorite movie with the word evil in the title?
This is going to be blasphemy to somebody, but the Evil Dead remake?
I still think that the only thing that kept people from not liking the Evil Dead remake was more the nostalgia for the original, because that movie's intense.
I think so, too. Now, I might be forgetting someone, but that comes right to mind. As A, it has evil in the title, and B, I liked it. I thought it was good. I haven't watched it in a while, but I really enjoyed it. I'm trying to think if there's anything else that I... there's a comic book I want to read called The Enormous Beard That Was Evil, but that doesn't... I did not love it because I haven't read it yet. So that's not a good answer to the question.
I kept thinking about how, like, there's a video game with the same title as this movie that's actually a pretty good horror game. Evil Dead is probably the one on my list. I'm just blanking on other movies with evil in the title more than anything else right now.
IMDb and do a search here. Let's see what we got. Yes, I hate you, but I know Keeper. So Resident Evil, the final chapter, not one of them. Okay.
I'm just putting in evil. Ouija.
more title matches. So there's Evil from 2003. The Evil from 1978, Evil from 2005. All right. Daredevil.
Yeah, I never realized that you can't spell devil without evil.
Ouija Origin of Evil was pretty good. I saw that last
year. For some
year.
Reason, this has Captain America Civil War.
Oh, does it?
Yeah, it's like, that's not evil.
Tucker and Dale versus Evil?
That's
pretty
a good,
good
one. I saw the devil once again. That doesn't have actual evil in there.
I'm trying to think of how civil... I got to Civil War II, and that's definitely not one of them. Jane the Virgin is on here. Jane the... Okay, I was thinking maybe, like, civil, like, I-V-I-L was... They were like, well, it's sort of similar, so I'll throw that in there.
It's
how did Jane the
similar.
Freaking Virgin get in here? No shade on Jane, by the way, because that show's awesome. But...
Well, this has, like, Dogville, too. Like, it's just anything close to phonetically evil. Evil
okay.
Angel, the evil gene, evil remains. I'm Man, still going to stick with probably Evil Dead.
I'm just going to go with I'm going to save this search for future use on Two Weird Didn't Watch. We're going to have a whole evil trilogy that is completely unrelated, but we'll make them related somehow.
Pleasantville is on here.
It's not Ville, okay? Evil.
The next comment comes from Mr. John Jones. He says, I don't have a question, just a statement. Hello, Al. Hello, Tony. I hope you're having a great day. Love and kisses, XOXO, John Jones.
Hello, John. This is Al. I hope you're enjoying your water bottle.
Yes.
This is Al.
Big I've never hug. Seen somebody tweet so much about a water
little
bottle
hug.
In my life.
Big keys, little keys. And that's going to do it for the podcast.
Big hugs and little kisses for all of you in the same vein as Mr. Nacho Libre.
We didn't pick a movie for next week, by the way,
yeah,
but
we
should go to humanechoes.com and click Become a Member to get access to awesome stuff. We are releasing our Kerbal Space Program videos one day early for members, so if you're a fan of that series, get in on that. You also get the bonus podcast and cool things like shirts and stickers and all kinds of stuff. If you're at the various different levels, you'll see how it's enumerated there, and that really helps support us. As we mentioned, we will cover a movie next week. We don't know what it is yet.
Speaking of pins and things that you get as members, we are designing the next pin right now. If you sign up for the $10 level, we are actually shipping you all the past pins up to this point while supplies last. So if you now's a good time to sign up so you can get all three of those pins whenever the third one drops. I'm going to let it not spoil, or I'm not going to spoil you guys to what this pin's going to be. I was about to let the cat out of the bag, but I think
I would have bleeped you, Tony. I believe it was the other podcast when you started yelling at people for not being members. I was like, Tony got salty there.
I was just trying to, you know, make it a little bit, like, a little more apparent than it.
It actually, by the way, for those of you who heard that and thought, like, you went on some, maybe they thought you went on kind of some kind of swearing terror, I'm glad that you thought that. That was what I was hoping that you would think. It was not that bad. But it was more, I thought it'd be funnier to put the bleep in than have him actually yelling at you for not being members. Anyway, you guys are awesome. Thanks for watching and or listening, and we'll see you next week.
See you then.